I see. I'm in Pacifica's good old living room again, facing her the same way a certain nun did once before. I'm sorry for wasting the time you spent searching for that job. I bow my head, so does Yoru. Sorry. It's fine. The cosplay shop was kind of shady, and nobody wants to do garbage collection anyway, and those men are kind of dumb, too. I can't speak for Yoru, but I can't say I could see you doing that sort of work, Sayako. When I look up, I see Pacifica's gentle smile. Oh, thank goodness she's not mad. She's perfectly calm. I'd probably be mad if I were in her shoes. I can still feel sorry, though. True. I just thought you'd have a plethora of options if we used my connections. Looks like this will be harder than I expected. Okay, once again. What exactly does Pacifica do? I want to ask that, but there's no way I can. But how do you expect me not to want to ask? I start to debate myself, but stay silent in the end. There's no point in forcing yourself to do a job that you'll quit immediately. I think manual labor only shows its true advantages if you're employed in the long term. Just take your time searching. I'm so glad to have your help. You are too, right, Sayako? Huh? Yeah, I'm glad to have your help. Sorry for the trouble. We're friends, aren't we, Sayako? I hear the front door start to open. It's probably Anya. Pacifica said she'd be here later. Anya said she tried to find us work using her own personal connections, but she also said, "My networking is poop compared to Pacifica's, so don't expect much," she said, before promising that she'd keep us in the poop. I mean, loop. Oh, is Anya coming too? As I grin for the stupidest reason ever, Yoru speaks up to me. I nod vaguely in reply. Anya's as hard a worker as anyone else, so she should have connections of her own. But I suppose anyone's connections would look like poop compared to Pacifica's. Let's splash some hot water on her as a penalty for being late. Yay. She's kind of scary when you think about her like that. Pacifica hands Yoru a kettle full to the brim with hot water as she gleefully waits by the door. What if she's got a dreadful side to her that I don't know about? Wait, I guess it's obvious that she does have a dreadful side to her, but what's truly dreadful is not knowing what it is. When I do come down to that side of Pacifica, will I be able to keep loving her the way I do? What if I told her all this? I can only imagine the worst. I don't want her to hate me. After all, regardless of the path that brought us here, she's the one who reintroduced me to the outside world like this. Maybe I should discreetly ask Anya once she's here. I'm sure that'd be better than asking Pacifica herself. As soon as I make up my mind, the living room door suddenly opens loudly and...
Don't move!
A man shouts coldly as he barges in the room, tearing the casual mood to shreds. In his hands is a high-caliber pistol, big enough to be used as a blunt weapon. All of us freeze and fall silent. Hey, Mort, the only people who can come visit my office without an appointment are top priority clients and my friends. And I don't have any top priority clients yet, so that means only my friends can visit unannounced. And you're not my friend. Please set up an appointment by phone and come again. You... Oh, swears. You shitty bitch. You ruined a once-in-a-millennium business opportunity. How dare you? How dare you make that face at me? Please don't get the wrong idea. I only did my job. It's the truth that you cut corners, isn't it? If you came here to bark at me, you're barking up the wrong tree.
Damn you!
Now put down that dangerous thing before you regret it. What? Do you have any idea what situation you're in? Wow, so cool. I had zoned out due to the surprise, but Yoru's ambiguous murmuring snaps me back to reality. We're up against one man. He must be tired holding up that gun or something, since his hand's trembling. I don't think he's used to wielding a gun. In any case, judging by his stout, protruding belly, he probably can't move very quickly. I didn't want that gaunt bastard to beat me. I've done everything I could to win. But then you had to butt in and ruin everything. You're the one who leaked everything to the company, weren't you? That's right. I did my job. My hands are clean. How dare you say that when you've been using your position to line your own damn pockets with such outrageous margins? Everything will be fine. I can take this guy. The situation... The situation itself isn't good, but I'm happy at the possibility that I can be useful to Pacifica. So what do you want me to do? I want you to die! What's the point? I'll just come back, you know. Do you have the brain of a child, Mort? Pacifica's voice is cold. Cold enough to freeze this man's beans. Pacifica's voice is cold. Cold enough to freeze the steam this man's been spouting. I can at least make you writhe in pain by filling you with lead. There's plenty of time to regain your company's trust. We've got all eternity, actually. Are you unable to make a rational decision? Shut up! Shut the hell up! Who gives a damn about your logic? How can you possibly know how I feel? The man's voice gets slightly teary. On the other hand, Pacifica's stance gets firmer and firmer, so much that I'm wondering if she can even see the gun in the man's hand. Oh, is that so? I understand. Allow me to make it up to you. Suddenly, Pacifica softens the tension in her voice. The man mumbles, but ends up not speaking. It seems like Pacifica intends to resolve this problem with money. I send her a look that says there's no need to do that. Pacifica picks up on my signal, but she responds with a wink that I'm not clever enough to decipher. Pacifica picks up the pouch that was left on the table and starts rummaging through it. She then takes out a small tube. It's probably lipstick. If you're going to pay out, then do it in cash. I'm done playing your games. Oh, that's too bad. Something shines in Pacifica's hand, and at the same time, a dry bang rings out. The man's gun hits the floor with a thunk. He then falls to the floor, holding his shoulder. I'm all out of cash, but I've got plenty of lead. It's only when Pacifica says those words that I realize that the lipstick in her hand is actually a teeny tiny gun in disguise. If you'd like a second payment of lead, then by all means, come and take it. Pacifica calmly asserts as she picks up the gun the man dropped and points it back at him. The gun looks too big for Pacifica's slender arm, but for some reason it looks more deadly than when the man was holding it. The man mumbles and groans, but no intelligible words come out. He must be in too much pain to speak. I can't hear you. Pacifica kicks the groaning man. Specifically, she kicks his gunshot wound. Oh my god. Instead of screaming, the man's body twitches and convulses. His body is collapsed face up. After losing consciousness for a few seconds, the man tearfully pleads with Pacifica. Mercy, please have mercy, it hurts, it hurts. Get lost, now, and be sure to tell your little friends exactly what happened here. You hear me? Okay, okay, I promise, I promise. Pacifica takes a step toward the man. It looks like bullets still lodged into his shoulder. The man squirms to get some distance, perhaps having recalled the pain of being kicked in the gunshot wound moments earlier. Know your place, shithead. And with those final words, Pacifica shoves the sole of her boot as far into the man's rear as physically possible. The man scuttles away, surprisingly quick, as if burrowing the momentum from the kick. Phew. I look at Yoru beside me. I kind of expected it, but her eyes are sparkling even more than I had imagined as she runs up to Pacifica and hugs her. That was amazing! Say that line again! Hasta la vista, baby! I didn't say that. Yo, what did I miss? Anya suddenly pops in through the door the man left wide open. Looks like things got kinda weird here. That, what's his face guy was here, wasn't he? You saw him leave, didn't you? I've already taken care of him. Oh, and that thing worked like a charm. I'd like to order a dozen. I quite like that sort of thing. Oh, seriously? I'm quite proud of my handiwork on that one. Wish I could improve the shell ejection, though. I know it can't work out exactly like the movies, but still. What does Miss Pacifica do, exactly? Yoru whispers in my ear. I feel ever so slightly relieved to know that she's been wondering the exact same thing as me. I'm not sure, but she's probably some sort of agent? An agent of what? Something. Once that noncommittal word leaves my lips, I realize I sound just like Yoru. It's kind of embarrassing. So, How'd the new job? So, how'd the new job go? Looks like it wasn't a good match. You got any leads? Nope, nothing. Sorry, I tried looking, but everywhere I looked, places were either understaffed, not overstaffed, just staffed. I see. I'm really sorry. No, I'm not blaming you or anything. I just think it's interesting. You know what I mean. I know what you mean. This town just seems like a perfectly put together machine, meant exactly for the number of people in it. Maybe the town's just optimized the way it's... Maybe the town's just optimized that way, since it's always had the same number of people? 1,024. That's the ghost town's ghost population. With the addition of Yoru, that's 1,025. Of those 1,025 ghosts, 1,023 are employed. Yoru and I are the only ones left out. Oh, but I did borrow that lemonade stand. Can a lemonade stand even make money in this cold-as-hell town? Are you sane? You didn't catch Clara stupid, did you? Anya mumbles the story about how she originally made that lemonade stand as a setup for a play, but it's perfectly functional. Sorry, I guess it's not useful after all. Maybe I did catch Clara stupid. Coffee, please. And with that, she throws herself on the sofa. I'm sorry. I don't say it out loud, but I apologize again in the silence of my heart. Okay, okay. Would you two like some more as well? Yes, please. Hip hip caffeine. I'm not entirely sure what I'm apologizing for. I feel a vague sense of guilt, and it's not something I can solve by raiding the church again. I was powerless. No trip to Pacifica's house is complete without a cup of Pacifica's house blend coffee. These two have a proper role in this small town community. They seem so important. Wait, then what was my role before I became a shut-in? Well, in the worst case... Pacifica comes back from the kitchen after boiling some water and walks up to me with cups in hand. You can be my bodyguard. Being an agent is dangerous work, but with a ninja around, ruffians like that one should think twice before they show their faces. So... Okay. Relax, no need to make that face. Pacifica gently pinches my cheek with her fair, soft hand. Was I making that bad of a face? I guess so. But why? I'm flustered. I want to rebuke myself for taking advantage of people's kindness like this all the time. I have nothing to offer. A bodyguard, I see. I never thought of that. Milk her dry, Sayako. That's why, even if I become Pacifica's bodyguard, I'll never feel useful, no matter how many enemies I take down. It doesn't change the fact that I'd still be taking advantage of her kindness. Oh, we forgot to splash Anya with hot water. It's not too late, you know. I'm not sure what you're talking about, but please forget about it for the rest of eternity. I've got a suggestion for Yoru when we get home. If she's receptive to the suggestion, I'll discuss things further with her, as much as possible. That way, I'm sure even I'll be tired enough to fall asleep without having to worry about her snoring. I think to myself as I watch Yoru brandishing the kettle. We'll work for money. Will work. As soon as I gave Yoru my suggestion, she energetically said, "Sounds good," in less than what I think is a second. We can't just take advantage of Pacifica's help forever, so let's do some job hunting of our own. That was the main point of my suggestion. Yoru said, "If we're going to do it, we've got to do it good," and then she made cardboard sandwich signs. No idea where she got the cardboard. I hid my astonishment at her craftsmanship. In my mind, I was applauding her. But her snoring is still way too loud. Her raw energy, both awake and asleep, is grating on the ears, which is why I don't praise her out loud. I don't know how many hours we spend with those signs in hand. I figured that having something to do would serve as a good distraction, but in actuality, the cold, the fatigue, and the shame are just wearing down on my mind. But I honestly believe that this is what I can and should be doing right now. So we do this today. And the next day. And the next day. and the next day. We keep standing and barking all around town. The end is near. Nuclear war. Buy gold. It seems like Yoru has had enough. I'm nearing the end of my rope, too. The town's workforce really must be saturated. Would anyone actually give work to job searchers with sandwich signs when every position's already filled? I just want to throw myself onto the snow and give up. That's when somebody calls out to us. Oh, Armageddon's coming, huh? You're always living on the edge, Yoru. Guess he's not calling out to us exactly. Just Yoru. And this isn't the first time someone's called out to her. While I've just been aimlessly wearing the sandwich sign, Yoru's been making acquaintances one by one, gradually assimilating into the town. Oh, Mr. Patel, how are you? Thanks for your help the other day. I feel a little better now. Not completely healed, but better. Thank you so much. Come visit the cafe again. You should hire us. Sorry, we've got enough workers as it is. I see. Be sure to tell us if there's ever an opening. Yeah, when the time comes. See you later. What happened the other day? I ask Yoru as I watch Mr. Patel leave. I listen to him talk about his issues. I didn't understand what he was saying, but I just nodded and said yeah to everything, and he seemed happy, so I guess it's all good. Is it, though? I'm sure he just wanted some validation from someone. Validation? Someone to tell you it's alright, you know? Is it really, though? Either way, he's doing his best, I think. You think so? Well, he looked happy, so I want to believe in him. As she says that, Yoru smiles ambiguously. Or maybe it's only ambiguous because I'm too dumb to understand it. But what I do understand is that her smile is awfully beautiful. It's so beautiful I'm jealous, almost resentful even. She's got such a beautiful smile. I'm sure she'll be able to find work. Unlike me. What? Oh, nothing. I'm going to go over that street. You stay at the plaza. As you command, my liege. I totter over towards the back streets. It's not somewhere you'd expect someone looking for work to go. I just want to be alone. I thought walking would cheer me up, but the more I walk, the more tired I become, so it looks like I'm playing a losing game. I remember a day long ago when I waited for the bus in the rain. I remember waiting 20 minutes for a bus that comes every 30, and fed up with waiting, I ended up taking the train home. Even though I knew the bus would be there in less than 10 minutes, I spent 15 walking from the bus stop to the station to catch a train. By the time I realized I had wasted the effort of waiting 20 minutes, I had already been walking for quite some distance. I suppose I was just tired of staying in one place. I didn't know what I was doing, so I just ended up doing something. It feels disgusting not to understand yourself. I somewhat feel like how I felt that day. Whoa. As I turn the corner, I bump into someone. You. You were at the church. I recognize who it is. That's right. It's the man who stopped me by the entrance when I snuck into the church. I bribed him with mints, and then killed him. Hey, is that the ninja? Behind the man are five similarly dressed men. His friends, I suppose. Yeah, that's right. I see the men reach inside their coats, either for concealed guns or bladed weapons. Leave me alone. I ask to be left alone, but I have to admit, I'm a little glad that a stress-relieving distraction has decided to waltz up to me.